Hello students, last time we have explained about the mounting of the 15 star larvae or mature larvae of the Silkworm bombyx mori from the feed beds to the mountage or chandrikas for spinning the cocoons. After the period of 5 to 7 days of spinning activities which have completed in the mountage, after which all the cocoons are harvested or collected from the mountage or the chandrikas, and after harvesting the cocoons are then stored in the storehouse, where the next activities like sorting of the cocoons, then marketing or sale of the cocoons will be done, and where the agricultural part of the sericulture is completed or ends. So in the mulberry sericulture, the first two stages or the steps of the sericulture, that is cultivation of the mulberry plant or the cultivation of mulberry crop so as to make available mulberry leaves for the feeding of the silkworm larvae of the bombyx mori, that is the first step of the sericulture. Then second step of the sericulture, that is silkworm rearing, starting with selection of the silkworm variety or the strain for the purpose of silkworm rearing in the rearing house so as to grow the silkworm larvae or the caterpillars of the bombyx mori in the rearing house by various methods, that is a self-rearing method, a flute rearing method, or a shoot rearing method. So there are various methods of silkworm rearing, and after the complete development of the silkworm larvae, that is attaining the last stage, that is 15 star larva, which are then transferred to the mountage or the chandriks for the spinning of the cocoons. So spinning activity of the silkworms that occurs or that happens onto the mountage or chandriks, and after the period of spinning activity or the completion of the spinning of the cocoons by the silkworm larvae, all the cocoons are collected or harvested from the mountages or the chandrikas, and after which these are marketed or sold in the market by making or by separating different type of cocoons so as to get the good price in the market. So after marketing or after the sale of the silkworm cocoons, the agricultural part of the sericulture is completed or it stops, that is mulberry cultivation and silkworm rearing. So these are the two steps of the sericulture, which is the agricultural part of the sericulture. Then after sorting and marketing, the industrial part begins, where there are again various steps. So prior to begin with post harvest methods or post harvest processing of the cocoons, so at the end of agricultural part, after harvesting of the cocoons, the step is, that is the sorting of the cocoons. So before to send the cocoons to the market, the prior to marketing or its sale, the sorting of the cocoon is done. So whatever the quantity of the cocoons harvested, that are separated or that are sorted out so as to make the its marketing, so as to make its marketing possible. So sorting of cocoons. So among the harvested cocoons, there are different type of cocoons produced by the silkworms. These are either slightly defective, highly defective, double cocoons, unhealthy cocoons, flimsy cocoons, pierced cocoons or cut cocoons. So there are different type of cocoons produced in the activities of the sericulture or in the sericulture. So these cocoons are separated. So slightly defective cocoon, highly defective cocoon, double cocoons, pierced cocoons, unhealthy cocoons or irregular cocoons or the cut cocoons, and all these cocoons are separated, and only good quality cocoons are sent to the market, and which will have the better price than the others. So it is essential to reject and remove these defective cocoons, and is known as a sorting of the cocoons. So all defective, slightly or highly defective, double cocoons, pierced cocoons, flimsy cocoons, which are not suitable for the reeling purpose, that kind of defective cocoons, and that should be rejected or removed, that should be sorted out from the entire quantity or good quality of the cocoons. So it is essential to separate these rejected cocoons, and it is essential to remove these defective cocoons, is known as sorting of the cocoons. So while sorting mainly double cocoons, thin-celled cocoons, dead and dirty, loose-celled, thin-celled and transparent, or thin middle-celled, frame-adherent and irregular cocoons are separated and rejected. So whatever the cocoons which are having a good quality, or that can be observed or that can be seen easily, that can be sorted out or separated easily. So defective cocoons or the bad quality cocoons can be separated easily from the good quality cocoons. So with the consideration of the different type of cocoons, that is thin celled, dead, dirty, loose celled, very thin and transparent, thin middle cell, frame adherent, irregular cocoons or double cocoons, these are the cocoons which are of poor quality cocoons, and thus these should be separated or removed from the good stock of the cocoons, and this is called as a sorting. So only good quality cocoons are collected for further processing, or these are only marketed. The color of the cocoons is mostly white. Besides this, there are different colored cocoons such as golden yellow, flesh yellow, bamboo leaf color or green color, as per the type of silkworms grown or cultured, or as per the strain or the variety of the silkworm Bombyx mori are grown or cultured for the purpose of sericulture. So on the basis of different varieties or the strains of the mulberry silk moth, or even the different type of silks, maybe tussar silk, muga silk or eri silk, these are also having different type of cocoons, and which can also provide the respective type of silk. And that's why there are various type of cocoons with different colors, variable colors, on the basis of the varieties or the strains of the Bombyx mori, which are grown or cultured or reared in the rearing house for the purpose of obtaining cocoon or the silk. So there are different colored cocoons can be obtained on the basis of the type of strain or the variety of the silk moth grown in the rearing house for the purpose of sericulture or to obtain the cocoons so as to obtain the raw silk. So the color of the cocoon is mostly white. In case of Indian varieties, the color of the cocoon is white. In a Japanese variety, the cocoons are yellow. So there are different agroclimatic conditions, and the different varieties or the strains of the mulberry silk moth Bombyx mori that is having the effect on the color of the silk or color of the cocoons produced. Then the cocoons of the domestic silkworms, the cocoons of the domestic silkworms are of various shapes. The cocoons may be barrel shaped, oval or round or spindle shaped depending upon the strains. So color of the cocoons and shape of the cocoons depends upon the type of silkworms or the variety of the silkworms grown or reared in the rearing house. So at the end of harvesting and sorting, the agricultural part of sericulture ends. So agriculture part of the sericulture ends with the harvesting and sorting of the cocoons and starts the industrial part. So up to this, that is cultivation of mulberry and rearing of the silkworms in the rearing house up to harvesting and sorting. So these are the steps of the sericulture can be described as the agricultural part. Now after harvesting and sorting, the cocoons are simply marketed or sold in the market, and from where or after that the industrial part of the sericulture begins. So this is the cluster of the cocoons which are white in color. Then in this image there are two colored cocoons. One is yellow colored cocoons and the white colored cocoons can also be obtained from the different varieties or the strains, that is Japanese and Indian. Indian varieties of the silk moth Bombyx mori, they yield white silk or the white colored cocoons, and the Japanese silkworms, they can produce the yellow colored silk or the cocoons. So these are the two type of cocoons can be obtained from the different varieties of the silkworm Bombyx mori. Then this is the image showing the marketing of the cocoon. So this is the cocoon auction or the sale, where we can see the different type of cocoons. So cocoons are having variable quality, can also be obtained in the rearing house. So these are different farmers and the traders who are involved in the marketing or sale of the cocoons of the mulberry silk moth. Then next point is post harvest processing of the cocoons. So after harvesting and sorting, the cocoons are marketed or sold in the market, and after which, immediately after its marketing, the post harvest processing of the cocoons begins. So very important or the initial step in the post harvest processing of the cocoons or in the industrial part, that is cocoon drying, because we know the cocoons which are harvested after about 5 to 7 or 8 days of the spinning contains the pupa inside. That is the live stage. The live stage of the silk moth Bombyx mori, that is chrysalis or the pupa, which is present inside of the cocoon, and that is the live stage, which is the dormant stage, inactive stage of its life cycle, and that will be transformed into the adult stage. And that's why it is very essential to dry cocoon completely under the direct sunlight or the direct heat of the sunlight so as to kill the pupa inside. So, unless and until we'll dry the cocoons completely, the pupa present inside can be transformed into the adult stage. So, immediately after harvesting, the farmer or the sericulturist has to sell the cocoons in the market so that the piercing or cutting or the emergence of the adult moth of the silk moth Bombyx mori will be prevented. So as to avoid or so as to prevent the transformation of the pupa into the adult stage. So if there is a development of the pupa and getting transformed into the adult stage, the adult moths emerge out by cutting or by piercing the cocoons from one side or one end. And thus, such type of cocoons, that is pierced cocoons or the cut cocoons, will not get a much of the price or the good price, because due to the cut cocoon or the pierced cocoon, it will become difficult to spin or to reel the silk thread mechanically, or will not get a continuous silk thread from the pierced cocoon or the cut cocoon. And thus, the most important step immediately after its marketing, or once the cocoons are sold in the market, so the first step, that is cocoon drying. And cocoon drying is very essential stage so as to kill the pupa inside. Otherwise, it will come out and the cocoon will be damaged, and that will not be reeled mechanically or by using machinery, or simply will not get the continuous silk thread from such cut or pierced cocoon. So, there are various steps of the post-harvest processing of the cocoons, that is cocoon drying. Then after drying, cocoons are stored in a paste-free condition or in the store so as to prevent the attack of different pests or the pathogens onto the cocoons. So, chances of damage of the cocoons increasing in the storage, because the insects or the pests like Uji fly, Dermistid beetle, or different other insects can also attack onto the cocoons and can damage the cocoons, can lead into a staining of the cocoons, or feeding or breeding onto the cocoons due to the pest like Dermistid beetle or the Uji fly, that can also damage the cocoons in the storage. So, there should be a proper care taken during the storage. Then various steps, that is cocoon peeling, then removal of floss, outer floss from the cocoon, then cocoon sorting, that is separation of the inferior or poor quality cocoon. So, after this sorting, separation or good or poor quality cocoons or drying of the cocoons, there should be a proper storage. Then next step starts, that is cocoon cooking or boiling. Cocoon cooking or boiling. So, due to cocoon cooking or boiling, a sericin type of protein, which is a gelatinous protein or a gummy protein, present around the silk thread. So, that will get dissolved in the boiling water or during boiling or cooking, and silk thread get separated from one another. So, this will become easy for reeling of the silk onto the machinery. So, next step is a silk reeling. Then, unreelable cocoons, pupa set, means again, there are various steps. So, While first step of the rilling, the silk thread is unwind. After cooking or boiling, the silk thread becomes separate or loose, cocoons become loose, and once we tie or connect the silk or end of the silk thread, that will be unwind and reeled upon the small wheels onto the reeling machine. So silk reeling, then re-reeling, so as to permit or allow the complete drying of the silk. The silk is reeled first, then again re-reeled, then inspection or inspecting the silk which has reeled upon the small wheels during reeling or re-reeling, then removal of undesired gummy knots, that is finishing. So as to separate or so as to obtain the good quality silk, so whatever undesired segments or the gummy knots of the silk which are present on the silk thread, that are removed, and a simple silk, then sieging skein, silk of ceriplane, then finishing, and finally the large sized silk yard. So firstly the silk skeins are prepared, then bundles, and then finally the large sized bales. So skein, bundle, bales, so these are the reeled silk with a superior quality. And after finishing, a good quality silk only separated and made into the formation of skeins or bundles or bales, or finally the large quantity of the silk that is transformed into a larger bundle of the silk called as a silk yarn, and which is the end product. And this particular raw silk, which is in the form of either skeins or bundles or bales or the silk yarn, that is then provided to the some textile industry so as to weave actual silk. So these are the various steps of the post-harvest processing of the cocoons, and this is the diagrammatic representation. So we will explain all these steps of the post-harvest processing of the cocoons one by one. So, post-harvest processing of the cocoons, and it is the industrial part of the sericulture, and it involves several steps. So, the first step of the post-harvest processing of the cocoons is stippling or drying. Stippling or drying, that is sun drying. That is, sun drying is usually adopted for stippling cocoons or drying cocoons to kill the pupa before to metamorphose or before to transform into the adult moth. So stippling means drying. Stippling means a drying. So the purpose of stippling or drying cocoons is to kill the pupa or kill the pupae present in the cocoons inside before to metamorphose them into the adult stage and emerge out by cutting the cocoons and makes them unreliable. So cocoons, such cocoon, once the adult moth emerge out, the cocoon get cut or pierced on one side, and that's why such cocoons cannot be reeled mechanically, or it becomes unfit for the reeling, or it become unreliable, and thus it is very essential first step in the post-harvest processing of the cocoons, that is stippling or drying. Stippling or drying, complete drying of the cocoons under direct heat of sun or sunlight, so as to kill the pupae present inside of the cocoons. If we are not sun drying the cocoons or killing the pupae inside immediately after its marketing, the chances of metamorphosis of the pupa into adult will increase, and ultimately within 3 or 4 days of the harvesting or its marketing, within a period of 4 days, the adult moth can emerge out. So this is just a time that is 10 to 11 days. So after completion of spinning cocoons within a period of 3 days, so on 4th or 5th days, cocoon should be harvested in case of multivoltine strains. Or in case of univoltine and bivoltine strains, cocoons should be harvested on 7th or 8th day of spinning cocoons. So after completion of the spinning, cocoons should be harvested on 5th day in case of multivoltine strains or the varieties, and in case of univoltine and bivoltine strains of the silk moth, cocoon should be harvested on 7th or 8th days of the spinning activity. And that's why immediately after its harvesting, that should be sorted and marketed first, so as to avoid the piercing cocoons, or so as to avoid the emergence of the adult moth from these cocoons, because the period of pupation is just up to 10 to 11 days. So if we are wasting about 7 to 8 days in harvesting, sorting and marketing, so within the next 3 days the adults can emerge out. So that time or that period, that is 3 or 4 days of harvesting of the cocoons, are very important, and during which the traders who have purchased these cocoons have to dry the cocoons first completely, so as to kill the pupae inside. Otherwise, there will be a total loss or damage of the cocoons, and all the cocoons will become unreliable, because the adult moths will emerge out and will not get a complete thread from the silk cocoons, will not get a complete thread and throughout the length. So there are fragments. You have to cut portion of the one side, ultimately will not get the continuous thread of the silk, and cocoons become unreliable. And that's why it is very essential to dry or stifle the cocoons completely. And usually the cocoons are dried onto the ground or onto the mat directly under the heat of sun, directly in a sunlight. And this is the best practice of stippling or drying the cocoons, so as to kill the pupae inside. So there are various methods of the stippling or drying cocoons. So first one is drying cocoons under the sun. Then second, hot air stippling, means we'll have to prepare or we'll have to use a machinery so as to prepare the hot air, and that could be passed on to the storage or stock of the cocoons. So that is a hot air stippling. Then steam stippling also. So we'll have to expose the cocoons, or a certain quantity of the cocoons, either to the hot air or to the steam. So there are these two methods of the stippling, that is hot air stippling and steam stippling. But best suitable and cheap and convenient method of drying or stippling cocoons is the drying cocoons under the sun. Then next step is deflossing. So whatever the undesirable mass or the fibrous mass which is unreliable present around the cocoon, that should be removed. That is called as a deflossing, removal of floss. Floss means it is a fibrous mass present around the cocoons which is unreliable, and that's why it should be removed, called as deflossing. So removal of unreliable fibrous mass from the cocoons is called as deflossing. Then next step is riddling. Riddling means grading. Riddling means grading, and during which there is a separation of large, medium, small sized cocoons, called as riddling. So this is simply a grading, so as to make the convenient practice of its marketing or its sale. And these different sized cocoons will have different price or different cost in the market. So the large sized good quality cocoons will certainly get more price, medium size will have medium price, and small sized cocoons will have less price, and thus all the cocoons should be riddled first so as to market them. So similar to sorting, the riddling is also of great importance so as to get more profit, or so as to get more cost or the price of the cocoons as a crop of sericulture. So riddling means separation of large, medium or small sized cocoons, that is grading, and is called as riddling. Then next step of post harvest processing, that is cocoon boiling. So the boiling of the cocoon is essential to dissolve the gummy protein or gum like protein called as sericin, which forms a coat of the silk thread and which binds or stick the winding turns of the silk thread while spinning. So at the time of spinning activity, when the silkworm larva release the substance of silk, when the silkworm larva, which is a spinning cocoon in the mountage, that release a substance of the silk through the spinneret, will have uniform release, or the source or supply of the 75% central part or the core of fibrous protein fibrin, and outer 25% a gummy coat of the gelatinous protein called as sericin. And this is how these two components are continuously released through the spinneret. And whenever this substance of the silk, that is central fibrous protein and outer sericin protein, when get exposed to the air, immediately it get solidified or it get dried and to become a silk thread. So that will be spun or spinned around the body of silkworm larva, and this will form a continuous silk thread from start to end. It will form a continuous silk thread, because this is the, we know this is the 3-day non-stop activity of spinning cocoon around the body of the silkworm larva. So the outer sericin protein, which is gummy or gelatinous, that is responsible for sticking the successive turns of the silk thread, which has released through the spinneret while spinning the cocoon by the silkworms, and thus so as to dissolve this gummy sericin protein which is present around the silk thread, should be dissolved so as to separate, so as to uncoil the silk thread, so as to uncoil or so as to separate or so as to unwind the silk thread from the cocoons, so as to make it easy to seek the ends of the silk thread, and so as to reel them onto the machine or the motor or the wheel. So the boiling of the cocoon is essential to dissolve the gum like sericin coat, which is present around the silk thread, which binds the winding turns of the silk thread. So boiling makes the silk thread loose. Boiling makes the silk thread loose and reliable. So the silk thread could be unwound or uncoiled easily while the reeling activity or the reeling process. So this is very essential step, that is cocoon boiling, so as to separate the turns, successive turns of the silk thread which has stuck together at the time of spinning cocoons. So cocoon boiling. Then next step is brushing. So this is the image where this is a cabinet like structure made up of prepared by using the iron sear or metallic and having number of trays where we can put the cocoons for drying. So this is the multi-fuel cocoon dryer where we can use coal or the wood so as to produce the heat, so as to create the heat, or so as to produce heat from the particular part or in the a gap which is a stove like, and that is prepared in the downward part of the multi fuel cocoon dryer. So where we can use coal or wood so as to prepare heat or so as to produce the heat source for the drying of the cocoons, and which can be kept in the trays in the multi fuel cocoon dryer. So this is just a drying machine. So instead of if there is no adequate supply or the source of sunlight at that time, one can use this multi fuel cocoon dryer where the cocoon drying and the pupae inside can be killed by providing the heat by using either wood or coal. So this will produce the heat, and that will help for killing pupae or drying of the cocoons in the equipment called as multi-fuel cocoon dryer. Then after cocoon boiling, the next step or the post-harvest processing, that is brushing. So brushing is essential to seek or to obtain the free ends of the silk filament from the cocoon, and it is done either manually operating brushes or mechanically operating brushes. So brushes means, we know the silk cocoons of the Bombyx mori having a continuous silk thread. So the starting end of the silk thread is present inside, that has prepared, or that is present inside while beginning of the spinning cocoons, and the last end of the silk thread will remain outside. So as to obtain the silk end, silk thread, so as to obtain silk thread, so as to tie it to the reeling machine, and this particular activity is done after cocoon boiling. Cocoon boiling or drying, cocoon first are boiled, then are again dried, and then after drying of the cocoons, complete drying of the cocoons, again in the sunlight, the all the cocoons that are exposed to mechanically operated brushes from the, so this is a superficial brushing, this is a superficial brushing or smooth handling brushing of the cocoons by using the brush, and due to this what happens, the outer end or the at the end of silk thread which is now present the outer side or to the outside or onto the surface, that will be separated due to the smooth or delicate handling or the brushing. So brushing can be done by using the brush, just like toothbrush. So there are brushes which can be, and these brushes are having hairs. These are having much longer hairs, and that can be swept with a smooth handling onto the dried cocoons after boiling. After boiling of the cocoons, cocoons are dried and then are exposed to the brushes. So there are mechanically operating brushes also, so to which the cocoons are exposed, and this will lead to the separation of the silk thread or ends of the silk thread, and this is easy practice to obtain or to seek the free ends of the silk filament or the thread, so as to start with the reeling activity. So as to start with the reeling activity, one has to seek the or obtain the silk threads that can then be tied to the reeling machine, and with the help of motor, with the help of small motor, the silk thread could be wind onto the smaller reels onto the reeling machine, and ultimately the cocoons will uncoiled, cocoon will be uncoiled, silk thread will be separated and get reeled upon the smaller wheels onto the reeling machine, and finally at the end of the reeling of the cocoon, the pupa, dried pupa or killed pupa will remain below. So as to obtain or so as to seek the silk threads or the free ends of the silk thread or silk filament from the cocoon, the activity or the step or the practice will have to do that is the brushing. So there are two kind of brushes, maybe manually operating type of brushes and the mechanically operating type of brushes. So brushing, this is a smooth or a delicate handling or a smooth brushing. This is a smooth brushing so as to seek the free ends of the silk thread, so as to make reeling practice easy. So after which there is a reeling. The next step of the post-harvest processing after brushing is a reeling. Now in a sericulture, we have used the term brushing twice. Remember, we have used the term or we have explained the term brushing twice in the sericulture. In the initial phase, that is while in the beginning silkworm rearing, in the beginning of silkworm rearing, we have used long feathers of the bird so as to transfer the first instar larvae or the newly hatched silkworm larvae from the egg card seat into the feeding tray or the rearing beds or feed beds with the use of long feathers. So as to avoid mechanical damage to the newly hatched larvae, we usually use to the long tail feathers of the bird, usually white in color, and that is also called as brushing. That is also called as brushing. Newly hatched larvae, that is black ants, or newly hatched larvae or the caterpillars of the silk moth, are transferred from egg card seat to the feed bed or the rearing trays by using the tail feathers of the birds, called as brushing. So that is also brushing, and this is also a brushing. So this brushing is important to seek or to obtain the free ends of the silk thread so as to tie them onto the wheels of the reeling machine. So while reeling, we'll have to obtain the silk thread or free ends of the silk thread, then only it can be tied to the small wheels of the reeling machine, and after which the entire silk thread could be unwind or uncoiled, and ultimately the entire continuous silk thread will be reeled up onto the smaller wheels of the reeling machine. So after brushing, the next step of the industrial part of the sericulture, that is post harvest processing of the cocoon, is a reeling. So the process of unwinding or uncoiling the silk thread और ब्रिन्स ब्रिन्स बिकॉज दीज आर वेरी थिन सिल्क थ्रेड्स आर वेरी थिन हैविंग डायमीटर लेस देन डायमीटर ऑफ द हेयर्स दे आर वेरी डेलिकेट और वेरी थिन सो नंबर ऑफ ब्रिन्स और नंबर ऑफ सिल्क थ्रेड्स कैन बी ब्रॉट टुगेदर टू फॉर्म ए वन सिल्क थ्रेड सो आफ्टर ब्रशिंग द नंबर ऑफ सिल्क थ्रेड्स कैन बी टाइड टुगेदर टू द रिलिंग व्हील और द मशीन ऑन द सेम स्पॉट सो एज टू फॉर्म ए सिल्क थ्रेड विथ अ डिफिनाइट थिकनेस सो द प्रोसेस ऑफ अनवाइंडिंग द सिल्क थ्रेड और ब्रिन्स फ्रॉम द ककून्स कंबाइनिंग ऑफ रिक्वायर्ड नंबर ऑफ ब्रिन्स कंबाइनिंग ऑफ रिक्वायर्ड नंबर ऑफ ब्रिन्स टू प्रोड्यूस सिल्क फिलामेंट्स सो सिल्क थ्रेड व्हिच इज फाइबरस प्रोटीन कैन बी ऑब्टेन फ्रॉम द सिल्क ककून्स और द ककून्स ऑफ द सिल्क मॉथ एंड नंबर ऑफ ब्रिन्स और द वेरी थिन सिल्क फाइबर्स मेनी सिल्क फाइबर्स कैन बी ब्रॉट टुगेदर एंड कैन बी टाइड टू द सेम प्लेस और टू द सिंगल व्हील वेयर ऑल दीज सिल्क थ्रेड्स और कॉम्बिनेशन ऑफ द सिल्क थ्रेड्स विल देन बी रील्ड सो दैट विल बी फॉर्म दैट विल देन फॉर्म ए सिंगल सिल्क थ्रेड सो द प्रोसेस ऑफ अनवाइंडिंग ऑफ द सिल्क थ्रेड और ब्रिन्स फ्रॉम द ककून्स कंबाइनिंग और कॉम्बिनेशन ऑफ रिक्वायर्ड नंबर ऑफ ब्रिन्स और द सिल्क थ्रेड्स टू प्रोड्यूस ए सिल्क फिलामेंट विथ अ डिफिनाइट थिकनेस विथ अ डिजायर्ड थिकनेस एंड वाइंडिंग इट ऑन टू द स्टैंडर्ड रील्स कॉल्ड एज रिलिंग सो रिलिंग इज सिंपली ऑब्टेनिंग द सिल्क थ्रेड फ्रॉम द सिल्क ककून्स एंड दिस इज डन बाय यूजिंग द रिलिंग मशीन सो After brushing, several free ends of the cocoon can be kept together or can be brought together, tied together, and that will form a silk thread with a definite thickness. And these are then unwind, means unwinding of the or uncoiling of the silk thread at the cocoon level, and that will be again. Winded onto the wheels. So unwinding and winding. So silkworms winds silkworms while spinning the cocoon. Silkworms or the caterpillar larvae in the mountage they wind the silk threads to form a cocoon. So after boiling of the cocoons, the silk threads get separated or the turns of successive turns of the silk thread get separated. After bursting. The free ends of the silk thread could be free or that can be easily identified. So that will be separated and tied together. So now number of brins of the silk threads with a very thin silk fibers that are brought together to form a silk thread of desired thickness. And then the silk thread will get unwind or uncoiled from the cocoon, separated from the cocoon, and then get wind up onto the standard wheels or the small wheels of the reeling machine. This is called as reeling. Then next step is re-reeling. So at first the raw silk reeled on the small wheels or small reels so as to allow complete drying of the raw silk and then re-reeled on the large reels. So in the initial phase of reeling, small reels or the small bundles of the raw silk are reeled on the reeling machine and so as to allow complete drying, these smaller reels are again unwind or uncoiled and the silk thread is again wind up or reeled onto the large wheels or in the form of large reels. So reeling and re-reeling. So reeling is done in the form of smaller reels, and re-reeling is done onto the larger reels or the wheels. At first, the raw silk is reeled on the small reels or small wheels so as to allow the complete drying of raw silk, and then re-reeled on the large reels or wheels. So, direct reeling leads to incomplete drying and the formation of hard gummy spots or the knots on the threads. So, while boiling of the cocoons, there may not be complete the gummy protein or the cerisine protein will not dissolve completely. There may be a little quantity of the cerisine protein or a gummy protein can remain with the silk thread during boiling. Actually, after boiling, the boiled cocoons or the after boiling cocoons are dried and again are then treated with the acid water. These are treated with the acid water and so as to dissolve, so as to remove the gummy cerisine protein completely from the silk thread. But still, there may be the gummy knots present on the silk thread. Due to incomplete drying, this will lead to the formation of the gummy knots or the spots on the silk thread. And thus, it is essential to dry the reeled silk in the form of smaller bundles first, then is again re-reeled onto the larger wheels. So, small reels, large reels, again large reels, then skeins, bundles, then bales are prepared. So, while this transformation of the raw silk, that is reeling, re-reeling, winding, unwinding during these activities, that is reeling, re-reeling, this allows the complete drying of the silk thread and this will lead to removal of various errors or the this will lead to the error in the reeling. So, quality of the silk will remain somehow poor due to the incomplete drying, and thus complete drying is essential so as to prevent the poor quality of the silk, so as to prevent the poor quality of the silk can be formed. And that's why, so as to get good quality silk, one has to take care of reeling, re-reeling like activities, so as to dry the silk thread or the raw silk completely, so as to avoid the chances of formation or production of a poor quality raw silk. So, reeling, re-reeling. So, first reeling is done onto the smaller reels or smaller wheels. Then re-reeling is done onto the larger and larger reels or wheels, and this will allow the complete drying of the silk. Even the gummy knots or the spots which are present on the silk thread, that can also be removed while reeling and re-reeling activities. Then last step, that is finishing. So, finishing means removal of visible defects from the raw silk thread, like oversize knots. So, oversize knots are the components or the material which is a part of a cerisine protein or a gummy protein that will form a oversize knots. Then loose ends, etc. So, removal of visible defects. So, whatever the visible defects present on the silk thread, that are removed from the raw silk, and these defects are in the form of oversized knots or loose ends, etc. And then silk is boiled. So, after reeling, reeling, the silk is again boiled, stretched, so as to remove or so as to eliminate the entire quantity of the cerisine protein which might present in the reeled silk. So, in the previous steps of the reeling or re-reeling, there may be the cerisine protein may remain along with the silk thread. So, that is removed at the time of finishing. So, first The visible defects, that is, gummy knots of the serine protein, loose ends that are removed, then the raw silk which has rilled, either in the smaller rills or onto the larger rills, is boiled again, then stretched, purified by acid, or acid water, and repeatedly washed to bring out the luster or a gloss characteristic of the silk. So, since the silk which is having a gloss characteristic, having a lustrous or shining, glistening property present on the surface, that will be obtained only when there are several type of treatments, such as boiling, rilling, re-rilling, that is complete drying, removal of visible defects in the form of gummy knots of the serine protein, then again rilling, re-rilling, followed by a boiling, then stretching of the silk thread, then is again treated with acid water, repeatedly washed, so as to bring out the luster or the gloss characteristic of the silk thread, that is shining, glistening appearance or the feature of the silk that will be exposed or that will made available on the surface of the silk. So, silk thread will become a lustrous or a natural fiber of the silk with a shining, glistening appearance that will be obtained in the final stage of the finishing. So, the threads are then changed to bundles or skeins. So, these are the silk thread which is then transformed or changed into the bundles. Bundles means of the silk thread or skeins with a size of 1.5 meter, 1.5 meter diameter and with a weight of 70 gram. 70 gram. So, very small quantity of the silk will be, or the bundles of the 70 gram weight, bundles of the 70 gram weight silk, raw silk, are obtained first. This is the metallic thigh reeling machine that can be operated manually, so as to uncoil or unwind the silk thread from the cocoon. So, that will can be kept in the vessel which is kept below the machine. So, this is metallic thigh reeling machine that can be operated manually or by using our hand, and the cocoons, boiled cocoons, can be kept in the vessel, and whatever the free ends of the silk thread or the fiber that are obtained, that are brought together and then tied to the wheel or the reel onto the reeling machine. So, this is the metallic thigh reeling machine where the small scale reeling of the silk thread can be done. This is also a reeling machine which is also which can be operated by using the electric motor or the power. So, with the help of power of the electric motor, we can reel the silk onto the different parts of the, or there are various number of reels which can be first reeled in those smaller bundles, then larger bundles, and again larger bundles. So this is the reeling machine where we can reel the silk thread or the raw silk into different sized bundles or the reels, smaller, medium, or large size. So, this is reeling machine. This is again another metallic pedal spinning charkha that can also be used for the reeling of the silk or obtaining silk thread or from the cocoons. Then silk yarn processing. So, see, this is also a reeling machine where on the top side of the machine there are large silk yarns which are prepared while reeling, and the killed pupae which are remaining below in the trays. So, due to the uncoiling of the silk thread, unwinding of the silk thread that has tied to the reeling machine, then By using or by beginning with the reeling machine, the silk threads are uncoiled or unwound and are simply reeled on the smaller wheels, then larger wheels, and finally in the form of silk yarn, which are present on the top side of the reeling machine. And we can easily see there are large quantity of the killed pupae which are present below or remaining finally at the end of the reeling, and that are now present in the trays, which are you can see these are the killed pupae which are present in the tray. And whatever the silk obtained that is reeled up onto the larger wheel on the top side of the reeling machine in the form of silk yarn. So this is again the silk finishing in progress. So this is also a reeling machine. We can see the silk which has re-reeled onto the top side of the reeling machine, and the ladies who are involved sitting close to the reeling machine, and these are involved in seeking or in obtaining pre-ends of the silk thread or the fiber, which are then tied to the reeling machine. So this is silk reeling or silk finishing in a progress. So this is the activities are important. These are the important activities of the silk reeling, re-reeling or finishing, so as to obtain the raw silk for its marketing purpose. The skeins, so while finishing, so this is the continuation of the finishing. This is the continuation of the finishing. So after removal of visible defects, after removal of visible defects or the gummy knots from the silk thread, the reeled silk or a re-reeled silk or dried or completely dried silk, which is present in the form of smaller reels or larger reels, that is then again treated or boiled so as to remove the remaining sericin protein from the silk thread or the smaller reels, then which are then treated with the acid water, then stretching of the silk thread, and whatever the visible defects that are removed while finishing. So removal of visible defects, then again boiling, then treatment of acid water, and so as to appear, so as to brought out, so as to bring out the gloss characteristic of the silk thread, that is lustrous silk thread, luster or a gloss characteristic or the character, that is feature, that is shining, glistening appearance of the silk thread will be obtained at the final stage of the finishing. And then this reeled, re-reeled, boiled, then stretched silk is then transformed into the smaller bundles with a weight of 70 gram with a diameter of 1.5 meter. 1.5 meter diameter bundles of the silk thread with a weight of 70 gram are prepared first. After these skeins with a diameter of 1.5 meter and weight of 70 gram skeins, bundles, then skeins, which are then made or transformed into the books. Then these books are transformed into the bales, that is large sized bales of the raw silk of standard weight, that is Indian bale with a 50 kg silk with a weight of 50 kilogram. In international market, the standard weight of the silk, raw silk bale is a 60 kg. So Indian bale is having weight of 50 kg. In international market, the weight of bale of which is prepared, the final product in the form of finished silk, having the weight, the bale having the weight of 60 kg. Then finally, testing. There are Indian and international standards to judge the quality of raw silk to facilitate its marketing. So whenever the silk with national or international standards that suit or that are having, if the silk is having the various aspects or the qualities to decide the criterion so as to get the best price or good price in the Indian or international markets, it should have some features or some qualities and that are tested with respect to the quality of silk. That is rilling quality, then the thickness of the silk thread, thickness of the silk means uniform thickness of the silk, then rilling quality. So there are various criteria which should be considered while finishing. So after finishing, there is a testing, and after testing, the silk means this is the a standard. This is the Indian or international standard. Testing means there are Indian or international standards to judge the quality of the raw silk to facilitate its marketing. So to maintain these standards, the raw silk is put to a number of tests to assess its size variation, winding quality, neatness, evenness, cohesion, tenacity, that is stretching means tenacity. So these are the some of the criteria and are assessed while testing the quality of the raw silk so as to facilitate its marketing, so as to get good price in the national or international markets. The silk should have some qualities or the some important features that are tested or assessed while it's marketing in a national or in a international markets. So there are Indian and international standards to judge the quality of the raw silk and to facilitate its marketing. This is for to facilitate its marketing. So to maintain these standards of Indian or international markets or standards, there are number of tests and that should be assessed. There are number of tests to assess its size variation, winding quality, neatness, evenness, cohesion, tenacity. So these are the some of the qualities or the features of the silk, or these are the important features of the good quality silk. So whenever these are present in the silk, obviously silk will have a better price. So that will have more demand or more scope for its marketing and can also provide us the good price of the silk after testing. So this is what about the post-harvest processing of the cocoon. So today we'll stop here. Today we'll stop here and continue the next lecture. In the next lecture, we'll explain the composition and uses of the silk. So today we'll stop here and remaining part of the topic that we'll explain next time. Thank you.